So moving on into the second game of the top eight, we are going to have the US v US showdown. You can see Philip Schultz in the same side of the bracket has progressed to top four. So already Grafton and Michael know that they will be facing Philip if they are the ones to progress.
Exactly. So we will have one more top eight match to show to you, and one will run simultaneously. So after this US showdown, we'll have one more match for you. But let's introduce the players first of all.
And yeah, absolutely. Michael Pramawat, aka Pram, known by many. You can see he has been a winner of regional championships. He's been a finalist as well at not only the US National Championships in 2014, but also in 2010. He was in the finals of the World Championships. So definitely known as one of the best players in the game. And he's constantly seen in these top tables. You can see he's playing the Yveltal EX deck. He's playing a very simplified version, very similar to winning lists that we've seen in Fort Wayne. And yeah, he's progressed all the way to top eight so far.
Yeah, and you can see players are high-fiving each other. Of course, you know each other. It's the community, the US community, making it very, very far into the tournament at the European Championship. So you have to give it to them. They have traveled very far. They are still jet-lagged. It's very early in the morning for all of us, actually. And here they are competing in the top eight. And now let's look at another familiar face.
Yeah, it's rare for Michael to be sitting next to an opponent who he can be so comfortable with. You may be able to question Grafton's fashion sense, but there's no question that he is a fantastic player. You can see he's got top four in state championships, multiple top fours in regionals, 2011 in the World Championships, and also USA Nationals top four. So always in contention. He's hoping to make it to top four again today, at least.
Yeah, we already saw both players on stream, and now with Grafton, we remember his face frowning a little bit when his Greninja deck whiffed out on energy a couple of times here on stream. So he's hoping that this is not going to repeat now that the stakes are very, very high. Best of three, top eight match, 75 minutes starting right now.
Absolutely, and straight away that we see two things have gone great for Grafton already. He's led with the Talonflame, and if we look at his prize cards in a moment, you'll see there's no Frogadiers in there. So already he can have a huge sigh of relief.
Well, there's two energy. We had one game where he had four energy and came back to haunt him when he ended, and he whiffed out on the energy that he needed so badly for his Frogadier. This time he has good prize cards on his side. Michael starting out here with a Fright Knight Yveltal and attaching Darkness Energy and benching Yveltal EX.
Absolutely. So that's all he can do, actually, as it passes over to Grafton. Not too many things he needs to do in his turn. I think because the attachment was to the active Pokemon, he might be looking to find himself another Froakie this turn. He's attached the Water Energy to his Talonflame, obviously going second. This is a great thing because it means he can go for the Aeroblitz to get himself two of any card and basically force Pram to find an N in response. Grafton, it looked like he had multiple Frogadiers in hand, so he's very happy to have the N here on his first turn.
Yeah, and I think Michael is equally happy about that N. So if you're Grafton, of course, you see that Michael's first turn was a very short one, so you're thinking twice about that N. But at the same time, you know, if you have Frogadiers in hand, you want to shuffle them back in, so you think, okay, let's have an N for both of us.
And he does find himself a dive ball. He's going to be able to use that for Froakie, because otherwise Pram would have the option to find double colorless and simply Lysander, the only Froakie in play. Grafton will be able to then conclude his turn by searching out with Aeroblitz, and that pretty much guarantees himself the Frogadier, so he can use duplicates next turn, as well as an energy if there's not already one in his hand. And Splash Energy is often the one that you would go for, because it can help protect your Frogadier. At the same time, he knows Michael's list at this point. We've already mentioned in the last top eight game, both players will have had the opportunity to see and scout out the opponent's deck list. Pram is playing Enhanced Hammers in here, so he may be having a more cautious approach.
Yeah, so perfect start if you're Grafton now. And if you're Michael, of course, you've seen that there's an Aeroblitz coming. Maybe he's looking to play an N. Here's the double colorless energy. And also he's looking to find a Trubbish very, very soon, because the clock is on now that Grafton has made his way to two Froakies. But nothing of that sort. No supporter from Michael, just the pitch black spear.
And absolutely, we have the ideal turn from Grafton, in my opinion. He's going to be able to find the Frogadier and the Splash Energy and combine that even with the Enhanced Hammer. And he's going to finish off with the Water Duplicates, filling up the rest of his bench with the three Frogadier that we know in his deck.
He could not have asked for a better start. And Michael, on the other hand, the opposite is the case. What is he going to do now to pick up some space and to keep up with Grafton here?
Yeah, the Fright Knight is often an attacker that is great in some matchups, but this is certainly not one of them. He's had to lead with the Fright Knight Yveltal, so he had no choice in the matter. He had to start with it. And it's sort of awkward for him, because especially because he's not found any pieces of Trubbish just yet. It looks like it's going to be clunky and stuck in the active position. He does attach Fighting Fury Belt to both Pokemon. At the moment, though, the Fright Knight ability is sort of cancelling out the fact that he has the tool on at all. So he's not going to be able to even take the one-hit KO on the active Frogadier this turn, by the looks of things, unless there's some sort of Max Elixir plays in the process.
Yeah, he has found himself the perfect card. Now he top-decked that, and because he had two Garbodor in hand, as we just saw, he didn't want to discard these if he drew into Professor Sycamore, might have been forced to do just that. Very interesting here, he attached the Fighting Fury Bell to the Fright Knight Yveltal, but just might as well do it. Floatzone is not going to do him any good. However, if he evolved into Garbodor, maybe the Floatzone could have helped him. What do you think about the Fighting Fury Belt here?
I think he just wants to simply put it on the board so that it's something that he doesn't draw into. He's still looking to get set up very much here, so he has drawn into the double Colossus Energy, which he does opt to attach. It looks like he's also got Shaman EX, which he's going to use to draw himself a couple more cards. There's a Max Elixir, which helps him out, but still, it doesn't look like he's got any form of finding Trubbish this turn, and that's going to be great for Grafton, because it means that he likely, as long as he can find one or two Greninjas in his turn, could be starting to get into the break evolutions before Michael's able to develop Garbodor.
Exactly, so there's one turn. If he's able to do just that, he's guaranteed one turn of Giant Water Shuriken in case he can evolve and also has energy. And Michael will again attack with Pitch Black Spear here. But there's another Shaman, so another chance for Trubbish. Doesn't get it.
Yeah, just a couple of cards from his final Shaman. He realized, although it's only a couple of chances, it's such a big deal to try and find the Trubbish if able. And it's a pretty sad amount of damage, just 60 with the Pitch Black Spear. Definitely not ideal for Pram here. And it's going to go over to Grafton, who has a fantastic hand, I must say. He's got Bursting Balloon. He's even got a Max Potion, which he could choose to use here. And it looks like he's got a Professor Sycamore, so he's going to be able to draw a lot of cards and try and access some Greninjas early on here.
Michael looks disgusted with that Max Potion. Come on, man. I'm just dealing 60 damage. Are you going to remove that? Here's a Faded Town.
Yeah, we see Grafton play down the Faded Town. It's probably a stadium that's, again, it's not really for this matchup. And we see him opt to attach the Bursting Balloon to the benched Talonflame. That tells me that he wants to try and find Greninja so that he can simply evolve, take full advantage of that free retreat, go into the Talonflame, and then use that attack to help him set up even further. It forces Pram into, once again, an awkward spot. The Talonflame has still 70 HP remaining, so again, it's even more awkward. So many reasons why Pram is in a lot of pressure here, because Grafton has started to get going. It's been one of these things that we've definitely seen on stream more than most times, that the Greninja players, they can just have really awkward hands and it doesn't work out for them. Using the Talonflame right now is a perfect opportunity to try and get more Greninjas out of his deck, and again, force Michael into the awkward spot. Maybe he has to end because he knows Grafton has a very strong hand. Maybe he has to Lysander around the Bursting Balloon and maybe take some easier prize cards. There's a lot of things going through Pram's head here.
Grafton shows us a lesson on how Greninja could run if it draws perfectly. And in this case, it just is the perfect start for him. I think he was looking for a Greninja with that Aero Blitz, the other card I wasn't able to make out. And here is a Floatzone. And finally, Michael is able to use the Yveltal EX that he's powering up with another Darkness Energy, and it will be enough to pick up the KO on the Frogadier already with this setup.
Absolutely. It's amazing that Pram was able to find the escape rope. That really helps out. As I was saying, he had the toss-up between going for Lysander or N, but in fact, the escape rope comes in very handily here, and he's also able to ruin Grafton's option of using the Aero Blitz and basically negating the fact that he did it in the first place.
Exactly. It's always very interesting to see if you compare Michael's deck to Philip's deck. Philip is not using any Fright Knight Yveltal whatsoever. And I was a little bit surprised to see that. But as you can see, Michael is using the Fright Knight Yveltal, and both made it here in the top 8. So there's reasons for both different variants of playing Yveltal. Same is true of the different ways you can play Greninja with or without Talonflame, for example.
I just want to pick up on the fact that Grafton chose from the escape rope to go into the Frogadier. Some people may question this, but I think this is because he's aware that Michael is also playing the Parallel Cities. If he was to bring up the Froakie, which is the easier prize that he would like to get rid of, if then Michael was able to put down the Parallel City, it could have cleared off multiple Frogadiers or even the Talonflame, which we do need to clear that Bursting Balloon off the board. But beyond that, everything's going smoothly here. Grafton is able to find his Greninja Break, and he's going to put the first Giant Water Shuriken down onto the Trubbish for 60 damage. There goes the Bursting Balloon. Awesome stuff there. And he does also have Ultra Ball in his hand. He can start finding potentially more Greninjas. So pretty good stuff from Grafton here. Putting the early damage on the Trubbish is going to be really helpful because now it's simply a Lysandra away at any point. to finish off the Garbodor. So great stuff. We do see the Ultra Ball going to help him get rid of a Talonflame as well, a clunky card from the deck. That's always one of the cards you want to discard with Ultra Ball. And he does find himself a Greninja. He then freely retreats back into the Talonflame. And again, he's going to try and set up his hand with the Aero Blitz. And you can see straight away why Grafton has gone for the Talonflame build of Greninja.
Yeah, here we go. He is playing one copy of Lysander. Unfortunately for him, he wasn't able to find it. So that gives Michael the window of opportunity to evolve into a Garbodor to bring it online with an item once the Aero Blitz is done here.
Yeah, absolutely. But it's not really that he needs to deny Garbodor too much this turn. I mean, he could be searching for potentially even Lysander this turn right now. If Michael wants to avoid the Talonflame, it can then Aero Blitz to KO and finish off the Garbodor. So plenty of, I think Grafton's still in a really strong spot here. When Greninja starts getting this sort of dominant board state and there's only one Garbodor that's going to be coming into play and it's already heavily damaged, this all looks like good news from his side of the field.
Absolutely. Another double catalyst to the active Yveltal EX. There is already an item, so all Michael needs at this point is the Garbodor.
Michael's been very effective at finding N every time there's been an Aero Blitz. So at least Aero Blitz has been forcing the Ns. It allows Grafton to continue getting a fresh 6 cards. So even though it looks like the Aero Blitz is basically doing nothing each time, it's still refreshing the hand at the very least, because otherwise Grafton would have been at a 2-card hand. And then the Aero Blitz gets him to 4, but then Michael is forced to shuffle in that hand regardless. So the Talonflame has been putting in work, basically forcing Michael into using the N every turn.
Yeah, and we already saw a quick glance on Grafton's hand. So he has a Dive Ball, another Greninja in hand. So right now he has every single evolution step in his bench. And he's going to be able to evolve them very soon. But here's that Parallel City, so he has to get rid of that Froakie.
Mm-hmm, absolutely, that's the easiest target for him to get rid of. It's the thing that he's least invested in. So now it's down to Michael to see what else he can do here. The Fighting Fury Belted Yveltal EX is still looking pretty intimidating. It does have a large amount of energy, but as long as no Garbodor comes down, I think he feels pretty safe if you're sitting in Grafton's seat right now.
Yeah, so if we're doing the math, so 140 damage is what Grafton can easily do with just one Greninja break if he finds two energy. And with 40 damage counters on it already, that will mean that Yveltal EX is going to stick around for a little bit more.
Oh, Grafton has an amazing hand here. He has the Dive Ball to find himself another break, and he already has two Water Energy in hand. So this is going to be a huge turn for the Greninja players. And this is what can happen. It can absolutely snowball out of control in a single turn. Grafton's going to be able to snipe 120 before even announcing his attack here. So this could be huge stuff. We know in his prize cards he does have access to Water and Splash Energy. The first thing he's going to do is snipe. Oh, and oh my goodness, one of the prizes he took was another Water Energy. So now he can freely retreat, then use the Giant Water Shuriken on his other break evolution, and still get a Moonlight Slash in here. This is absolutely huge from Grafton. A really, really big turn.
Yeah, that's fantastic. He's guaranteed himself ability to use the Giant Water Shuriken next turn. He is using...
He chooses just to use the Moonlight Slash. He doesn't want to use the Giant Water Shuriken this turn. This is an interesting play from Grafton. He's thinking, you know what? Garbodor's not coming down just yet, so I'm not really sure what target's best to choose here. This Yveltal EX is going down regardless eventually. I can always snipe it the following turn and then maybe get an extra attack damage on something else on Michael's board. So normally you want to see the Greninjas start cashing in as quickly as possible here. It's an interesting play from him.
I would agree. We have another N, even though there was no Aero Blitz. Michael says N is working for me, so let's do it again. 4 cards for him, 5 for Grafton. It doesn't look this way, but Grafton is still behind in price cards. This might change very quickly, though.
Yeah, this could all change. I believe, did the Yveltal EX start off with 40 damage on it before the Moonlight Slash? Because there is the... the Parallel City is facing the other way. That's absolutely fine.
Yes.
Okay, so we are going to see Michael go for the N, of course. Grafton is going to draw 5 cards, while Michael draws just the 4. But really, it's all about trying to find the Trubbish again. Really, it may even be a little bit too late for Michael, because... as long as he puts just one Trubbish down at a time, it can always be targeted by the Giant Water Shuriken. So we do see he at least finds a Yveltal EX and a Darkness Energy, and he's going to start putting pressure on one of Grafton's Greninjas. He's also going to have a look through the discard pile. Although in the earlier rounds in Swiss, players may be considering scooping at this point, you have to remember that in these top 8 games, there's actually 75 minutes for the best of 3. So there's no real reason that Pram should worry about... the time here. It shouldn't be a factor. And Grafton, wow, as soon as Michael announces his attack, the first action that Grafton makes is, you know what, I'm not even going to draw for turn yet. I've got the max potion.
Exactly.
This is great right now.
However, Grafton is unlucky here because he has no access to energy whatsoever, so Michael bought himself at least one turn here.
Ooh, and here comes the Trubbish, and if Grafton doesn't have the ideal hand, Michael could still be in this game. We do see the Pokemon Center Lady. This has been seen as a tech card for sometimes mirror matches, but additionally here, he's basically wiped off an attack from a Greninja.
And he didn't notice that Grafton was not able to pounce back because he wouldn't have used the Y-Cyclone in that case, and now his Yveltal is left with only one Darkness Energy.
And there's a Team Flagrant from Grafton. It's a supporter that is going to potentially slow down Michael, but really it's not a draw supporter. It's a rare card that you see in Grafton's list, the Team Flagrant. What do you think about it, and is it in here for any specific matchup?
I mean, if you look at this situation right now, I mean, both players are kind of stuck in the situation that they are currently in because both are struggling for energy, so I like this in this situation immediately. And Michael is checking his discard pile, not really sure what he just drew, but he needs access to energy quickly to cash in on the situation. It's Sycamore.
Another big decision was Grafton chose not to retreat for one thing, and also he's holding on to another max potion, so he's trying to figure out how much value he can get. As long as Michael doesn't draw into a double colors energy, this can be heavily rewarded, because of course, if he does find DCE, he could go for the Y-Cyclone for the knockout, thanks to the Fighting Fury belt. But he's sort of gambling that Michael doesn't get into the double colors energy, so then he can sort of cash in on two attacks with one max potion, and that could flip the game very much here. So it's kind of a bold call from Grafton. He was almost prepared to sacrifice the Greninja break in order to get extra value from the max potion. So it's a brave call, and it looks like Pram has got one max elixir to the bench, and he just passes it over. Oh no, he's going to allow the cut the deck, of course, and he's going to attach just a dark energy. And it's going to be the evil ball, so Grafton's gamble pays off.
It does pay off, and there's another max potion. This time he waits until he draws a card, and there's another N, I believe, in his hand. So he got himself out of this situation, place the super rod beforehand, make sure that Greninja and energy making their way back into the deck, and then place the N.
This is going to be an absolutely huge turn, helping out his odds here by using the super rod first. He's just saying, you know what, water energy is at this point the only thing I want to draw into. I've already got two Greninja breaks out. I'm going to play the end. As long as I can draw into these water energies, I'm just going to out-strengthen whatever Michael has. You can see the evil ball not doing too much damage. This is one of the best things about the Greninja break. Not only does it have a high HP, it also returns energy to the hand. So it really doesn't give Yveltal any favors here in terms of helping it get its damage output up, which we often see with other decks. So Grafton's got to be in a strong spot here as long as he starts finding a couple of water energy. And oh my goodness!
How about that?
Exclusively water energy and one bursting balloon as well, so he can freely start firing off some giant water shurikens. He's going to use one for the Trubbish, second one for the Trubbish. He never wants to deal with Garbodor at any point. He's going to have to take one prize. He's going to bursting a balloon, also a water energy attachment for the turn, and he's going to be able to use the Moonlight Slash if he wishes. And he's got the, I think it was the Ultra Ball off of his prize, and he's actually choosing to Shadow Stick. Oh no, he is going for the Moonlight Slash, but opting to hold the water energy in hand here. I think this is really because he's down to four prize cards, and Michael has been firing off ends all game, so the damage isn't so relevant right now. I may as well just sort of keep it on board so I can guarantee an attack next turn.
Yeah, he did the map real quick and he figured it was always going to be a two-hit KO from Michael. Doesn't matter. He can attach the water energy and keep it at the active Greninja break in this case. And if you're Michael, it's the common theme you have with Yveltal facing Greninja. In the beginning, you're able to pick up a couple of KOs, usually on the Frogadiers, usually on the Froakies. But then once the Greninja break are out there, once there's maybe even Rough Seas, Max Potions, it's really, really tough to pick up those KOs and really have to hope that your opponent doesn't find energy for a couple of turns. Unfortunately, this case, Grafton was able to draw himself out of the situation within two turns with the N.
Absolutely, and basically now that there's almost no hope that Pram can get Garbodor up, it's basically down to what he can deny Grafton in terms of draws. So we are going to see Pram is going to use the Lysander here, opting to bring up the other Greninja. This is so that he can avoid the bursting of balloon damage at all costs. And he is considering his options here. He's actually just going to go for the evil ball to finish off his turn there.
Yeah, there's another Faded Town, so Grafton does not have many options available, only Water Energy and that Faded Town for him. And remember, the Parallel City is still up, so you might think about using that Faded Town. Here is, first of all, the Giant Water Shuriken.
Giant Water Shuriken, and he is going to be able to finish off with the Moonlight Slash, currently 180 damage on the Yveltal EX. He's considering his options, what attack to go for. There's already two Shaman EX down on the board, so he's just going to choose to use... I'm not sure he could have used either in that situation. We know that at the very least he's chosen to keep the water energy on the board. So yeah, good stuff from Grafton, and he picked up two big cards, the Professor Sycamore to get him out of the otherwise dead hand, and also the Splash Energy, which is going to be helpful with preserving some of these Greninjas.
Yeah, what do you do if you're Michael here? There's a Float Stone now. I mean, Grafton only has two prize cards left, so you, Michael might as well go for the 7 prize card game, which means that he can promote Yveltal. If that's giving up a prize, it doesn't really matter because he has only Pokemon EX left, dealing a little bit damage, but it's not getting him anywhere because here it is, Water Shuriken on the Shaman, he needs one more energy.
He doesn't get it off the Professor Sycamore. That's not to say that he's still not in great shape. He could even choose to go for the Moonlight Slash on his active so that he's simply able to recover the water energy so he's guaranteed it for next turn. It could force Pram into then maybe a Sky Return play, which then seems to be like a spiraling out of control. And we're going to see Grafton continue on. I really like the aggressive approach. Obviously, it was the way to win that turn, so it was a good call from him. We are going to see both Dive Balls played together, maybe trying to thin the deck. It means that he can't draw into those when Pram is likely to try and look for the end, because if we do indeed see the Moonlight Slash, the Water Energy coming to the hand, Michael's forced to play N, otherwise he's guaranteed to lose the game.
Yeah, we just saw a quick glance off the deck, and there are like 4 energy left in there, so the Professor Sycamore for 7 was very, very unlikely to whiff on the energy, but he did actually.
Yeah, they were just checking out the numbers there. Obviously, the Fright Knight is an ability, so he is able to... the Fighting Fury Belt is ignored thanks to the Fright Knight ability, so that means he is able to take the one prize. I think that means that he didn't Shadow Stitch. Oh no, Shadow Stitching would have worn off by that time, so that's absolutely fine.
So, well, is there any way that Michael can come back here? I mean, the good news is that in the top 8 we have more time for both players, but still it says nope, scoop.
Yeah, he's got a scoop here. He knows that Grafton has the water energy in hand to finish off, so as long as he can't play N, there's zero possibility of him coming back into this game. So very good stuff from Grafton, and when Greninja does get going, it's a very intimidating deck to play against because that setup was so brutal. Pram found it took way too long really for him to find the Garbodor, and that's a big factor. Really, you want to find it turn 1 or 2 before he starts getting into his Greninja breaks and deny that damage, because you could see Grafton just has so much control over Pram's side of the board. He's able to knock out Trubbishes whenever they come down one at a time. He's able to knock out and increase the damage output he can do on the Yveltal EXs, which are the big threats. And one of the issues as well, Pram sort of had the slowest start possible. He led with the one thing he doesn't want to lead in this matchup, because it's not even able to knock out Frogadier's very effectively. Grafton got the Talonflame. Everything seemed to be in Grafton's favor and out of Michael's control there. So really, this could be a completely different game. Michael's going to be able to get to go first. Maybe he leads with a different Pokemon. Maybe he's able to find Trubbish with Floatstone a little bit quicker. So he's still very much in contention here.
And as you know, we'll have one more top 8 match coming up after this one. Another one was played simultaneously. That was Jacob against Pedro, and Jacob, packing his Yveltal deck, was actually able to advance to the top 4. So Pedro, with his Volcanion deck, made a top 8 finish. Congratulations to him. We are going to see Jacob in one of the top 4 matches coming up very, very soon.
Yeah, so far 2 Yveltal decks progressing from top 8 into top 4. Michael's going to hope to be another Yveltal making it all that way. Grafton, of course, hoping that that's not the case and that Greninja can keep carrying on. Again, the big factor is the opening hand for the Greninja. Looks like Grafton's first one is going to be a Mulligan. That means that in the opening 7 there was no Pokemon available to him. Even if you do have a Talonflame in your opening 7 cards, as long as you don't have an actual valid basic Pokemon, you can sometimes even choose with the ability with Talonflame. If you think the Talonflame, yes, it's a great starter, but the rest of my hand is bad, he can even choose to Mulligan. So he has very low statistics of getting basic Pokemon, and he even has the choice of making more Mulligans available to him. This is awkward though, because Pram is going to be the one going first, so Pram does have access to the card regardless. Normally an N can sometimes stabilize that and mean that it's not ever a factor. Just one Mulligan from Grafton as he's ready to go, and it looks like Pram is able to do the same thing here. So yeah, we'll see what both players lead with, and Pram is having a few decisions. It looks like the prize cards look pretty safe. Once again, no Frogadiers for Grafton.
Yeah, sometimes playing Greninja is like dealing with a crazy genius. Sometimes it works perfectly, but on the other hand, sometimes it just, you lose on the first or second turn just because you can't get another basic Pokemon down. You don't have access to anything. And looking at Grafton's hand, there's lots of energy. You haven't been able to figure out exactly what he has. 2 Versus Seeker in his prize cards, another Dive Ball, Greninja, Ace Trainer, energy, so that's not all that bad. For Michael, however, he has to deal with a Shaman start, and he's trying to recover from that.
Absolutely. We see the opening Ultra Ball. He's forced to get rid of a double colorless energy in order to find a Yveltal EX. He's going to have a quick scout of his prize cards. As is often natural, there's six cards that you have to put down at the start of the game that you're not allowed to see. And these could sometimes be precious resources. Michael is probably thinking, I really hope that there's no Trubbishes in there, no Garbodors, and he's in the clear. None of those pieces are in the prize cards, so a few Dark Energy is pretty awkward. That means that he's less likely to hit off some of his Max Elixirs, because he does need to really get his Yveltal EX as powerful as possible in order to get through breaks, you know, before they start becoming a huge threat.
Yeah, here's the first one. Let's see if he can hit it regardless. No, he's feeling it already. He's feeling the odds of free Darkness Energy being in his prize card. So, unfortunately, no hit for him this turn.
Yeah, absolutely. I don't really see what he's going to look for. Obviously, trying to find a Float Stone for the Shaman EX, he's most likely going to be committing energy to the active. The Max Elixir could change things, though, a little bit. And obviously, it's going to be looking for Trubbishes. Things like Fighting Fury Belt for the EX is handy. This time, he does hit one Max Elixir, so even with three in his prize cards, he's still able to get one, so he's got to be pretty happy with that.
That's good for him. So both players, he's deciding not to shuffle the deck. There's another Darkness Energy, so if everything goes well for Michael, he has also Fighting Fury Belt. He has an N for six. He might find himself a Float Stone, and then the start from Michael's side looks much, much better.
Yeah, he looks in pretty good shape here. Again, he has another Shaman EX, which he could play down. There's plenty more play that could go on from Michael. That early Yveltal EX with the Fighting Fury Belt looks pretty perfect from now. Grafton's hand wasn't fantastic. He had a splash energy, but he would have been forced to end immediately as well. So we'll see what he's able to draw into. We know that the Greninja deck is vulnerable. He's not started with the Talonflame, so just a 60 HP Froakie is the only thing standing in Michael's way currently. So it's really down to Grafton to try and fill his board up of at least one more Froakie and try and get into the Frogadier for turn two. That's really the thing that you have to sweat out as a Greninja player.
Yeah, it's funny to think about it. He has seven cards now. Oh, there's another Sycamore, so he has more than that to find another basic Pokemon. So yeah. Another Professor Sycamore, but still no Froakie, so he has to sweat it.
Yeah, absolutely. And Pram here, he's got a couple of options. Looks like he's got Parallel City in hand. He's mulling over potentially another Ultra Ball here. Normally when you see players trying to pick out cards from their hand and separate their hand, it probably means they're counting how many they have remaining for Ultra Balls. And he's debating whether it's worth looking for Trubbish this turn or maybe have the option to use other cards next turn. We do see one energy onto the Froakie, and it's a pretty big Sycamore from Grafton. Only a couple of things too painful really there. The supporters aren't great, and we know that...
he whiffed on it!
Ooh, this could be a bubble flip here.
He
can
whiffed.
See his face. There's going to be the Silent Lab stopping Michael drawing a few cards, which could actually be a bailout option.
Bubble
here.
Tails!
Bubble Tails.
There's energy!
So it's down to energy, and... Well, Pram's just going to make sure everything goes right here. There's the double colors energy to retreat, and he's going to use Evil Ball, and suddenly we're into game three.
Oh, this is soul crushing. All of a sudden, Grafton, look at Grafton's face. It's all over again. He has deja vu from the very first stream.
We know that there's been so many times when this has happened. Pramawat's been in this situation before, getting his way into the top 32 on the first day of the tournament. One of the reasons why he got there was because he was able to deal with the Froakie in one turn after... there was no other bench Pokemon, and again, it's happening to Grafton, and he's got to keep his cool here, because there's still a third game to play. We remember in the stream on the first days when he did have pretty bad starts, we could see on his face and we can see in his play that it was affecting him emotionally, and it's only ever going to be more emotional when we're in a top 8 game, especially against someone like Pram. It's come down to the wire, and he's got to keep his head here.
Yeah, the stakes are so high. I was talking about the crazy genius. Here we saw it again now from his worst side. Greninja not being able with 14 cards he was able to see to put down the second basic Pokemon. It's only playing the 4 Talonflame, so if you're not starting with these, there are only 3 Froakie left.
Yeah.
So of course he has to rely on dive balls, but he wasn't able to find them.
I know. I feel like you need to have a heart rate monitor for the Greninja players, because those first two turns are always such a roller coaster. You can see he's almost in a praying position right now, Grafton. He's thinking, please deck, please give me Talonflame, please
there
give me dive balls. He has got those things, so really good stuff here. Although he has 2 for Talonflame, the ability only allows you to put it as your active Pokemon, so there's only ever going to be 1 Talonflame that ever gets value. Start to see the prize cards here. There's 1 Froakie and 2 Frogadier.
Oh my.
This could be another problem.
Oh my. And I also didn't see any energy in Grafton's hand. There were dive balls, though. So let's see if he can draw out of it. This hand doesn't look pretty either.
Oof, dear. Grafton is going to be going for a couple of dipoles.
He's
this
gonna
is going to be
now.
His first deck search, and
let's
we'll see
his face.
Maybe the smile starts dropping a little bit here.
Oh, no, we can't see his
those
face.
Prize cards.
Oh, no, you saw it. You didn't see it on the secondary screen, but he was blinking profusely for a moment. He has to check it again.
Oh, dear. This is, again, one of the issues with Greninja. Not only does it have plenty of cards that you don't want to draw in specific orders, but additionally, the prize cards can be so painful for you. We do see the first dive ball. He's just going to find one Froakie. This means he can pretty much, if he feels safe enough, he can only use one dive ball and potentially try and get Froakie in next turn. But instead, he tries to hold it. He thinks, my Froakie's probably safe here. It forces things like escape rope, plus elixirs, plus energy. It's a lot for Michael to combo into. So instead, he's going to say, you know what, just one Froakie is going to be fine. I'll leave Talonflame in the active for now. It goes over to Pram. We do see the Floatstone, and we're going to see an attachment for turn, as well as a setup for a few cards.
Unfortunately for you, you weren't able to see both players' faces, but when Grafton was going through his deck, there was a microsecond of frustration in his face, and I think Michael picked up on this.
Yep.
There was a little smirk on his face when he started his turn, and Grafton is really just hoping, closing his eyes, hoping that he's going to make it through those first turns, because he needs to find energy, he needs to find a supporter, he needs to find those Frogadiers out of the prizes.
Absolutely, and someone like Pram is definitely going to capitalize and notice these subtle things. It's something that you see poker players do. They try their best to hide their emotions. Grafton's not doing that. Grafton's showing his disgust openly as soon as he does his first deck search. This is something that sometimes Pokemon players just simply can't hold back. There's a lot of pressure on the line, and although he's been in these situations before, it doesn't make it any easier being in a top 8 game.
No, but luckily for him here, Michael was not able to capitalize as soon as he started his turn. Shaman is still active. We have Yveltal on the bench, and now he's able to use another dive ball. I think he drew into an ultra ball, so that's not going to help him. He's not playing any Shaman, so Grafton will have to sweat another turn.
Yeah, and no energy for him either, so he can't go for the duplicates this turn, nor can he go for the Aero Blitz to try and improve its hand. So instead, we know he has the Ultra Ball in there, so he may as well find himself another Froakie, because Michael's much more likely to be able to access the bench to knock out a Froakie this turn, so he's got to protect himself here.
Yeah, you're going for, what are you going for if you have the Ultra Ball? Yeah, he's keeping it, because maybe if he draws into an energy, he can use then for Frogadier and then try to at least get one more Frogadier out of the deck with water duplicates. And now Michael has found himself a Trubbish, also energy for Shaman to retreat and then attack with Evil Ball for the first time this turn.
I wonder if he has anything else like Lysander that he can... Oh, that's pretty big from Pram. He gets the Lysander, so he's going to be able to get an Evil Ball knockout here. Start trying to race as quickly as possible. He also finds a Floatstone for Trubbish. A lot of good things going Pram's way here.
It does, and here is Froakie number one. Grafton knows the timer is on. He finds some energy.
Ooh.
Just in time delivery.
Yeah, absolutely. That energy does change a few things. We are going to see Grafton choose to go for the Ultra Ball. The question is, does he go for the water duplicates? He knows he only has two Frogadier this game until he starts accessing his prize cards. He is going to Ultra Ball find Frogadier. The question is, do you go for the water duplicates now, or do you potentially go for Aero Blitz? Yes, okay, this is what we're going to see. We're going to see him go for Aero Blitz instead. We know that he's also prized a Froakie, so he couldn't even access a third Froakie here, because that would potentially be a little bit safer. But now he just has to cross his fingers, hope that Pram doesn't have a backup Lysander as well as energy to really deal with his only Frogadier. The reason he's going for the Aero Blitz is because he's got so few Frogadier physically that he's going to have to try and maybe find Splash Energy to try and almost adopt the situation where he has more.
But if Michael finds that Lysander and another energy, Grafton will find himself in an awkward spot where he has to come from behind. And if Michael can keep the Lysander flow going, there's no way that Grafton can come back here.
This is going to be a really big turn for Pram. He's got the Fighting Fury belt because of his prizes. As we see, he plays the Shaman EX down. He's going to draw a few cards here. There's a Dark Energy, a few Yveltal EXs. Let's see if there's anything like VS Seeker, just Parallel City. So Grafton,
there's
the VS Seeker.
He has everything.
He also has the energy, so he's going to be able to use the Lysander up the Frogadier. We're going to see the attachment, and he can simply go for the knockout here. So really huge stuff from Michael. He also gets the Garbodor down. Grafton's face is the real picture here, what's going on, and he knows how hard it is going to be now for him to come back. There's only one Super Rod in Grafton's entire deck. He does have it, though, so he's going to try and recycle these frogs and once again, just try and get something going here.
I have bad news, though, because there was a double colorless in the prizes for Michael, and he picked it up. So if Grafton is not able to get rid of the double colorless, let's do the math real quick. That's yeah, five, that's six energy, that's 140 damage. Teleflame is going to go down. There has to be a Froakie right now, or the game is over.
Absolutely. So Grafton is going to use a big Professor Sycamore. There's
he finds it.
Both Froakies, so that could be really good stuff. So he's two prizes down, but by no means out of this game. He does also have Frogadier already in his hand. So again, this is going to be an Aeroblitz turn, most likely, unless he wants to risk a bubble. That could again be a turning point. But instead, he needs to improve his hand. I think, again, Splash Energy may be a priority. Something like Enhanced Hammer could help, even Lysander to try and stall turns. There's a few options he can go for here.
Yeah, now very interesting. If Michael had access to another Lysander, do you go for another Froakie, or do you pick up the KO on the Talonflame?
It really depends on what his hand is. I think right now he might even want to start drawing more cards so he can get into more Yveltal EXs, start powering those things up. If he already has Yveltal EX energy in hand and he has access to VS Seeker, most likely it would be a Lysander play, put Grafton under even more pressure. But let's bear in mind that we know that there's two Frogadier's prize, but Pram doesn't, so he could still think that the Froakies are high-value targets here. So he is going to limit Grafton's bench now that he's put down a couple Froakie. This could even give the illusion that Grafton has more Frogadier, but he just can't put them onto his bench because of water duplicates being shut off by the parallel. But it looks like we are going to see the double colorless energy get attacked all in on this one Yveltal EX, and he's going to be able to knock out the Talonflame here.
Yeah, Grafton is taking some time to decide which Froakie to promote. He settles for the left one and evolves it into Frogadier. And here's going to be one sad water duplicate attack.
Absolutely. We do see that energy. We do also see the Bursting Balloon. And not much else he can do. He's going to Lysander up the Yveltal EX. They all have a two retreat cost. So this is going to be potentially a way of helping himself survive. And there is the lone Frogadier. You can see his face.
Look at Michael's face.
The discard pile, shakes his head to Grafton, and he says, sorry bro, sometimes this happens.
This is, Michael can't believe his luck here, and on the other hand, Grafton is, he's in disgust, and disgust, despair, I don't know, but Michael now is facing an Yveltal that is stuck in the active spot. He attaches a darkness energy, so if he is able to find another Floatzone, let's check, he has two Floatzones in play. I think there's another one in his deck.
Yeah, there's also the Escape Rope, which would be the ideal card here, because then you also evade the Bursting Balloon. So Pram's going to be digging hard for this end. He only gets three draws, whereas Grafton gets six. If not, Grafton could have bought himself a turn here and maybe a way back into this game.
Max potions on Grafton's side, not what he exactly needed right now. Maybe Team Flagrant can give
just
him
the pass from Pramawat. So yeah, the Team Flagrant could be big here. The Bursting Balloon does have to get discarded. He's going to be able to evolve up into a Greninja at the very least, because he does have Ultra Ball now. Those max potions clogging up the hand a little bit, but it looks like he can at the very least discard the Talonflame. Here comes the Team Flagrant most likely. I think this is a great way to, again, make Pramawat in the awkward spot of having to find a switch card.
Yeah, this could be a little bit of a comeback time for Grafton. Now the momentum is shifting just a little bit. If Michael is not going to be able to attack for a couple of turns, Grafton might make the most of what he has right now.
Yeah,
and if he's able to pick up a prize or two, he might even get access to another Frogadier.
Yeah, it all really depends on what that three-card hand is from Pramawat. Did that end slow him down enough to really have no options, or does he still have something like VS Seeker or access to Professor Sycamore? So Grafton finds himself Ultra Ball. The Greninja's out now. He can start putting some damage on the board. He can also Moonlight Slash that energy back to hand. Obviously the Garbodor's up, but it means that it's less damage for Pram, so he has to find energy to actually try and finish off the Greninja instead. We're going to see the attachment for turn and a bubble play.
And it gets heads. No Floatstone, no double colorless retreat, so Grafton buys himself another turn, and he's looking like, should I be happy? Is this another way of getting back into this match, or am I still frustrated about the whole situation? I don't know, but the double colorless Michael has actually is invested into the benchmark because he has a Floatstone, so this bubble was big.
That was an absolutely huge flip. You saw he did have the Floatstone. There's the Professor Sycamore. We see more commitment of energy onto the Yveltal EX. That thing's pretty much ready to go through all of Grafton's deck as long as he can get it in the active position. Grafton stalling for time, and he's doing a really good job here. That bubble was huge.
Absolutely, but let's remember, let's assume that Grafton would come back into this match. There is a Garbodor online. We forgot to almost mention that the Garbodor was a thing, so even if Grafton was able to bring out a couple of Greninja Break, remember they are only limited to the attack for now, so 60 or 80 damage output per turn. No giant Water Shuriken for now.
I think the biggest deal here is that the Yveltal EX, that it's everything that Michael has really in terms of his board state, and it's already got 80 damage on it from earlier Talonflames. This damage may seem irrelevant in the opening turns, but now it's going to really potentially help Grafton into finishing off that Yveltal before he loses the last three prizes.
Yeah, six energy cards mean 140 damage guaranteed with Evil Ball, and there's some more turns he can take until he's actually attacking because he's still not able to retreat. And there's a Max Elixir, and he hits it.
And it goes back onto that one Yveltal EX. So plenty of energy on that guy. He's going to be ready to go.
Yeah, and Grafton, not to say, yeah, not bad, man, not bad.
Yeah, that's the 180 with the base damage of Evil Ball as well, because there's plenty of Dark Energy on there. I think that's four Dark Energy and two Double Colorless. So Michael's going to be able to charge through the entire board that Grafton has, no matter what. So we are going to see the end there, and hopefully for Grafton, he's going to be able to get maybe another Greninja going. Potentially Bubble again is going to be the option for his turn. Until basically Michael comes up, deals with the Froakie, then Grafton can start attacking and damaging the Yveltal EX. But really it's down to what Pram can draw into. Can he get maybe something like Lysander proactively? And again, the bubble flip could be the difference here.
Taking your opponent out is also a winning condition. So if he bubbles him to a...
This is pretty good. We see the Greninja as well as the Enhanced Hammer. So Pram now not able to charge through the entire board. He'd have to find another double colorless as long as Grafton always returns his own energy to hand. So this is a pretty big deal. Grafton is going to be able to look through the discard pile of Michael's just to make sure that what resources are remaining. And he might just be going for the bubble, it looks like here. That looks to be the safest option.
Yeah, bubble heads would be amazing. It would buy himself another turn, but you have at this point you'll have to ask yourself, if I bubble heads all the time and Michael is not decking out, what is my overall game plan? Because Yveltal is always going to get stronger on the bench, and as long as there's enough energy for the Evil Ball to one-hit KO any Greninja break, as long as it's doing 170 damage on its own, there's nothing that Grafton really can throw at him.
But and for it's now, another big heads.
It's heads.
I think Grafton, really, he just wants to find another Greninja break if possible, and he has to be the one proactively going for Lysander onto the Yveltal EX to have any hope really of dealing with it, because Pram is fully invested on that one attacker. He's hoping his Yveltal EX is going to be able to take all three prizes, and Grafton's essentially hoping that he can target it down first, get the initial amount of energy on the board, damage on the Yveltal EX, so that he's able to basically two-shot it from this point because it does already have 80 on it. So it's still very much in the balance, and I think Grafton could even come back with this game.
Yeah, and let's not forget, Michael has another Yveltal EX on the bench that has no Floatstone. There's no Floatstone left. So if Grafton finds another Versus Seeker for another Lysander, even if he's able to, or if there's another Tails for the bubble, he could go for the other Yveltal EX and stall for another couple of turns.
So here's the Greninja break that we were waiting for. There's a VS Seeker as well. I wonder what he's going to go for. It's going to be the Lysander. Okay, so this is the turn that Grafton's going to go in. He's got everything he needs now. He's got the Greninja break with energy. He's going to choose to Moonlight Slash and put that extra 80 damage on top of it. So Yveltal EX down to just 10 HP, is that right?
That's right.
So Pram now, everything's invested. It's still everything all in. And Pram might be trying to, I'm not sure what he can do to really deny Grafton, because we know that Grafton has the energy in hand. We are going to see the Fighting Fury Bear onto the Yveltal EX. We are going to see the VS Seeker. It could well be for something like Professor Sycamore. He's just going to have to try and find maybe if there's any more Max Elixir still in this deck, or just energy for turn attachments. And really, if Pram is able to, because the Froakie is still on the board, all he needs is really three energy to Y Cyclone to finish off a Froakie. That's got to be his win condition at this point, because there's no way he can get a Yveltal EX big enough like the one in the active position to deal with another Greninja break. It's just too much HP.
Is this going to be one of the greatest comebacks we've seen here in London? It could very well be. Michael is going to pick up the KO there on the Greninja and go down to two prize cards, but at the same time, then he has nothing left in terms of energy investment on his board.
Yep, and there goes Grafton's Greninja break. But that's everything. That's all of his energy going off the board. Grafton is going to be in a really, really strong spot here. And he's even going to complement that with the N.
N to two. And if he's picking up two prize cards, the way they are aligned right now, it's very likely that he's going to pick up a Water Energy and a Frogadier to evolve his Froakie on the bench. It's really, really looking as if Grafton is going to be able to make a comeback here.
This is absolutely incredible stuff. Now, Grafton has a lot of prize cards to take. Yes, he's taking the board control here. And that's going to be a huge aspect. But Pramawat, if there's one thing he has got, it's turns. He's got things he can promote into the active with float stones. He's got the shamans. He's got other things to try and build up another Yveltal EX. A lot of energy going off that board. And Grafton's able to take one of his Frogadier. This looks like good stuff for him.
It is the Frogadier, and he is nodding now. Now I can do something. I'm back into this, right? And now here's Michael. There is the Max Elixir, and he hits it. So he is able to bounce back here if he has another energy to attach to.
Yeah, I believe he definitely does have energy to attach. So Grafton choosing to keep the water and energy on the board might mean that Pram is able to get an extra 20 sneaky bit of damage in here if he is going to be going for the evil ball. Both players looking through the discard piles of each other. This is pretty much coming to crunch time. It's a very important time in the game here. So both players making full analysis. Grafton most likely looking for how many VS Seekers and Lysanders are remaining in Michael's discard pile. Also the Pokemon Center Lady is sometimes an option. Pram looking through things like bursting balloons, how many Frogadiers have gone. We're going to see the Professor Sycamore getting rid of a Garbodor.
And there is energy among those seven cards, and now Michael is able to bounce back with an Evil Ball with free energy attached to it and a Fighting Fury Bell that's going to be 90 damage. Wait a minute, maybe even more. No, he whiffs.
Yeah, so this is every little factor is big here, and it's really a turning point in the game. So Pram, we saw that he did draw into energy, so he will be able to attack with this second Yveltal EX with the Fighting Fury Bell. It's still a huge thing for Grafton to get over. He's going to be sort of waiting on how long it takes him to get that other Greninja out. The one Greninja break that's currently in the active position, it's going to have to tank a few hits. Now, we know he does still have Max Potions in his deck, and this could be the time where Max Potion becomes the difference here.
Yeah, for now, we know there's a Fighting Fury Belt attached to the Yveltal EX and only Moonlight Slash coming from Greninja, so the maximum damage output is going to be 80 per turn. That means a free hit KO at best on the Yveltal EX if nothing changes. Grafton is evolving his Froakie into a Frogadier now, and I think he also has a Bursting Balloon in hand, so that might also deal some more damage to Michael and also stall for some time until he's able to evolve his Frogadier again.
Absolutely. So this Bursting Balloon is a big decision. We know Michael is in a race for prize cards. He wants to potentially deal with a Frogadier if possible, but additionally, the threat is that one last Greninja break. So we are going to see him choose to Bursting Balloon the active. This means that Grafton's going to be able to get at least some damage in. We are going to see a Dive Ball from Grafton. It's kind of unadvisable to put down any more bench Pokemon because then Michael would be just a couple of Lysanders away. He has the option of potentially going for Splash Energy, but here we're going to see the end from Grafton, really trying to limit what Pram can do. So I really like this option.
And that's very big because he also looks for the Max Potion. He has to find that Max Potion and another energy to be able to heal off that Evil Ball damage there and potentially take another hit from the Yveltal. So let's see if he's going to find it in four cards. Let's see it. No!
Ooh, just a whole load of energy for him. Splash Energy is not really something that he wants because it gives the Yveltal more damage with the Evil Ball. So instead, he's choosing to put the energy back into his hand. Let's see what Pram's got off of those two cards as well as his top deck for the turn. Straight away, he's going to start looking for the discard pile. Both players gone for a lot of resources at this point, and it's really just going to see what they have left. And Pram does have the VS Seeker for the Lysander.
He does choose to go with the Lysander, but at the same time, it's giving Grafton another opportunity to find himself a Max Potion with the Professor Sycamore that he has. I don't know how big his deck still is, but I think he can go for it.
Grafton's considering what to put on here. He does go for the Splash Energy over the Water Energies, and here is the big Professor Sycamore.
He needs it.
He needs to hit. Ooh.
He doesn't find it. That's it.
Okay, so currently the Evil Ball is doing just 70 damage, so Michael just needs one energy to get there, and we are going to see the big Professor Sycamore here. Let's see if he can hit. Energy is for the game here. And
there he finds the double colorless
energy. All he needs to do is attach and announce the Evil Ball attack. And wow, Grafton so close to making that comeback. You could see how under pressure Michael Pramawat was. However, in the end, his Yveltal deck was able to overcome all of those Greninjas.
What an amazing match, I have to say. This was back and forth, the first game for Greninja. It looked perfectly, everything ran according to Grafton's plan. Then game two happened, we don't know what happened. Somehow Michael won in the second turn. And then Grafton made a perfect comeback in game three, but somehow Michael managed to still make sure that he wins it. Another Yveltal advancing to the top four, so that means we have three Yveltal into the top four and one more match to go.
Absolutely, and so soul-destroying for Grafton. One game of Dead Draw and one game where two Frogadiers are prized. This is the stuff of nightmares. This is what you hear about Greninja and you say, oh, I got so unlucky, this happened. And in such a high-stakes time in this tournament, it is so harsh for Grafton. But let's take nothing away from Michael. He made every play very correctly. He saw his win condition. He used every resource available to him. I think that was potentially one of his last VS Seekers as well. So he really did well to squeak out that game after the one big Yveltal EX strategy. That kind of went out the window because Grafton had the answers.
Yeah, unbelievable. I mean, if Pokémon taught me anything throughout the last couple of weeks is that first you have to prepare for those Yveltal. We see now three of them advancing to the top four. And the second one, maybe don't leave your phone unlocked.
Well, yeah, maybe that too. But the Greninja deck, I mean, we've seen it so many times on stream. We saw in the first game how dominant Grafton got. That board state was amazing. And you can see how strong the deck is when it is functioning on all cylinders. It's so difficult to play around. Has so many options, free retreat, movement between, great abilities, great attacks as well. Everything's very efficient, just one energy. There's not much that you need when you finally do get set up. It's just getting to that stage can sometimes just be such an ache.
It's just amazing to see two players of the best level that we have available here at the European Championships in 2016. It was a battle of the United States here, so one of them is guaranteed to advance to the top four. It's going to be Michael, and Michael is going to face Philipp Schulz now in the top four in a mirror match between the Yveltals. This is going to be a very, very exciting match. I'm really much looking forward to it.
Yeah, absolutely. We've seen both players. They've both said, I have text for the mirror match. Pram, he has Delinquent, he has Team Flagrant. Whereas Philip, he has Ace Trainer, he has Jirachi. So it's going to be a really interesting battle between these two in the top four. However, we do still have Michael and see his thoughts on stage now with Ryan.
Hello everyone, I'm here with Michael, our victor over Grafton. 2-1, such a clutch game that they played. Oh my goodness, what a match that was. How do you feel right now?
You know, I'm pretty ecstatic. It wasn't actually that great of a matchup unless they, some things go right for me. So game one didn't go so well, but game two and three pulled it out.
And what do you feel were the main key turning points in that matchup?
I got energy really quickly for game two and three, so... Game one, I was a little slower, but you really just have to outspeed that his deck in order for you to win.
Did you have an original strategy going into the match, or did you find you had to variate your deviate your plans a little bit as it went along?
So because everyone's been on stream already, you can kind of know what everyone else is playing. So I spent basically last night just kind of hitting this one matchup over and over. So I think I came in pretty prepared. Yeah.
Wow. So you actually knew you were facing off today, and you went over your opponent's game plans.
Yeah, I basically wanted to know what he was trying to do against me and what I wanted to do against him. And so, if I came up on anything, on the spot that was bad, I would already know it was bad. But so I just came in pretty prepared.
Okay. And you're from the U.S., is that correct?
Yeah, that's correct.
What would you say some of the differences are with the communities? I know, obviously, there's a massive following in the U.S. as well. Have you noticed any differences being here in Europe?
I think both areas are really excited about the game and... You know, everyone's super friendly, which is something we all share. So, yeah, overall, just the only thing that's different is we all just speak different languages here. So, you know.
Oh, I think we all speak the same language of Pokémon, that one international language. And how do you feel your chances are here today to go all the way?
I think all the Yveltal decks made it through, so it's an all Yveltal top four. I'm pretty confident in the mirror match, so I think I'm going to do well. Yeah.
All right, I won't ask you to give away too many secrets, but that has been Michael. Thank you very much for your time. Good luck for the rest of the tournament. Take it away, casters.
Thank you, Ryan. So Michael putting in the night shift here to prepare for that Greninja, I think it paid off.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, you can see he knew exactly what he was doing throughout the three games, putting as much pressure on as possible, taking advantage of those low HP early prizes before they just become way too out of reach. So that is going to conclude the third game of the top eight. And the second game, we'll be coming to the third game now, and that's going to be Yi Wei Chun versus Tord Reklev, and that's an interesting matchup as well.
Exactly. Stay tuned for this right after this. We'll be right back.